Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Our speaker tonight has informed me that everybody was very hushed when he was the convener, full of expectancy for what he was about to say. But I can see that tonight you weren't really waiting for him at all. You were enjoying the chinwag. So. But anyway, it's good to see that, as he said to himself, I'm glad I didn't put everybody off the last time and a few of you have turned up again. So I'll hand you over to, what's your name again?
I've forgotten.
That's a good start, Sandy.
Thank you, Malcolm. Ladies and gentlemen, he makes it up as he goes along. And so do I. So, let's get straight into tonight. On my last lecture, I realised that I began to get diverted and moved away from the pristine core of what I was trying to say. But tonight I'm going to try and be a bit more concise because there's quite a lot to cover. As you know, the topic is the streets of Stornoway. And the streets of Stornoway is a lecture which I first gave, believe it or not, something like 25 years ago in the town hall when the society was in its very early days. In fact, it hadn't started business then. So tonight is the streets of Stornoway, which is an abridged version of a book that I'm preparing to distribute through Stornoway mm-hmm. Historical Society, really about the biography of Stornoway based on its street names. Now, tonight I won't have time to mention the streets in connection with the people, the characters, famous some of them, who actually lived and were born on the streets I mentioned. Tonight I'm merely going to deal, as it were, with the origins and the reasons why the streets were called what they are. And in my last talk, just for a brief recap, I mentioned that Stornoway, you might call it Old Stornoway, Central Stornoway, was based down on Point Street and Cromer Street. In fact, one could say all the way back to Matheson Road and out as far as Behead. But I did say that Stornoway, Old Stornoway, had three satellite villages: Caunabai, or Behead, Enoclete South Beach, as it was officially known, in other words, Newton, and what you might call the lost village of Cotill, Crocknagower, which did actually disappear as a village some 2.5 centuries ago and began as a new part of Stornoway in 1900, but we'll come to that. So let's tonight, without much ado, let's go down to Newton, or as I said, Enoclete South Beach Street, or South Beach Enoclete, whatever it was called in the census at the end of the 19th century. Now, I'm not sure, and perhaps some of you who are Gaelic experts will know the derivation of the name Enoclete. There's a bit of a mix-up between some of the authorities on that. One author, that is Magne Offenthal, who wrote a substantial booklet on the place names of the villages of Lewes, and he was a Scandinavian who was obviously concentrating on the Scandinavian or Norse roots of the name. And he, funnily enough, decided that Enoclete was in relation to juniper rock. Now, Clete, obviously, rock. The inference is that Ena had something to do with juniper. You will know it's not a particularly common tree in Lewes or indeed the Western Isles, but it seems to be a common enough name in early Norse literature. So we have a possibility of junior rock, and I think much more credibly in D.J. McKeever's Place Names of Lewes and Harris, Enoclete is Ena Cletter, a rough, rocky ridge under the brow of the stone. And I suppose if you go down the seafront at Newton and take away the wall and stand on the beach and look up, you will see that the beach at Newton, rather than coming up like that to the present day level, actually came like flat and then up maybe 6 or 7 feet to street level, and that could have been the rocky ridge. But be that as it may, well, we're going to go down Newton. Just as on a small point, because it happens to me to be very topical, I'm only aware of two families still living in Enoclate or Newton, who have been, or their roots have been there for the past 200 years. And I refer to my own family, the Mackenzies, the family of William Mackenzie, born 1789, died 1874, my great-great-grandfather, and next door, and I want to just take the moment quite solemnly to say this, my next-door neighbour at 34 Newton, Mary McLennan's family, also stayed there. She was descended from her great-great-grandfather, Donald McLean, who was there from 1781 to 1845. Mary, as many of you know, is the widow of my dear neighbour, Fred McLennan, who passed away just a fortnight ago. But these are the only two families I know that have had a continuous link with Enoclate and are still there. The street of Enoclate, South Beach Street, seems to have become New Town by 1861. The N from New Town has been dropped. We now call it Newton. And we're going to go along the seafront of all, and we start at the bottom of James Street, at the roundabout there, where we go into the road called Immerslicoch. Now, funnily enough, that name, Immerslicoch, didn't become officially the name of the area until as late as 1956. Perhaps the reason for that is Immerslicoch, modernly translated as Shell Street, was not until 1932 a thoroughfare for traffic. You could walk from the round, what is now the roundabout, down to the beginning of Newton through a lane. And the reason for that was because the road was blocked off by the patent slip. No time tonight to talk about the patent slip, except that many of you will remember the sign on Newell's Mill, Patent Slip Wools Mills Limited. And that's because the patent slip run by one Aeneas Mackenzie, who we'll refer to later on, dated 32 James Street when he died, had his patent slip there, where, would you believe it, Stornoway, in the middle of the 19th century, had a flourishing boat building and ship repair yard. And as I say, the slipway for that yard came down into the beach, roughly from where Tesco's car park is now, down into the beach, beside what we used to call the lifeboat shed. It's now the area of ground occupied by the electrical company called Medlock, to put you in the modern geographical context. Now, this was Shell Street, and perhaps I ought to mention the very first house in Shell Street, where the oil depot now is, was a very the home of a very famous Lewis man, Kenneth Morrison, who, like so many Lewis people, Island people, emigrated to where else, not in this case Glasgow, but to London. And in London, in the middle of the 19th century, he set up what was called the Railway Clearing House. You can imagine, as the railways developed in the 19th century, there were very many of the railway companies throughout Britain. And in order to coordinate the sale of tickets and so forth amongst all those companies and the exchange of revenue and tickets, he set up a clearinghouse, which was very, very famous and didn't really disappear until the nationalisation of railways in 1948. Now, carrying on down Immerslicoch, we come to what is called Ferry Road. It's not particularly well signposted. You may not recognise it, but it is that little road beside Tesco's running from Bells Road down to Immerslicoch. By pure coincidence, it now leads with a new roundabout directly into the ferry terminal. But it that, given that it was name was applied to Lifeboat Street, as it was originally called in 1933, it seems to me to be an almost miraculous foretaste of what actually became. But the street, as I say, was originally Lifeboat Street, and those of us who remember the old lifeboat shed that was there up until about 25 years ago will understand why it was called Lifeboat Street. And Lifeboat Street leads from Bells Road. Bells Road. Actually, Bell was the name of the first manager of the gasworks created by Sir James Matheson in the 1850s. And Mr. Bell was the first manager. And like so many other places, it got its name because there was a house, there was a character, somebody who lived on it. So it was called Bell's Road. And now we carry on down the seafront, that is the present-day Newton Street. And parallel to Newton Street, there is, of course, Enoclate Road. Now, Enoclate Road was until 1932 or so, Enoclate Road was actually called, very appropriately, Kipper Road. And that shouldn't surprise anyone who remembers Stornoway, as most of us do, in the heyday, or just slightly after the heyday of the herring trade, when Enoclate Road and indeed Bells Road were the centre of the Kippering businesses, and there were half a dozen Kippering businesses along with. So it was called Kipper Road up until from 1889 up until about 1932. And before that, would you believe it, it was called Old Ropework Road. Now, we all know, or many of us know, the Ropework Road. Malcolm in particular knows Ropework Road, now going under the name of Westview Terrace. But we'll come to that in a minute. The old Ropework Road is because there was a ropeworks, one of two in Stornoway at that time. And this one was run by a gentleman called Alan Mackenzie. And the ropeworks were roughly where Clinton's Yard is now. And I certainly remember as a lad playing football in that area before it was developed, there was a large wooden thing that looked almost like a ship's mast. It was broken off at the top. It was maybe 10 feet high, and it had a white circle around the top. I didn't know what that mast was until much later on, and in point of fact, it was the fulcrum point round which the rope makers wound the rope as it was being pulled and made. So that was the old ropework road. And moving back from Enoclate Road, we come to a comparatively new road, and that is Riggs Road, running from Clinton's Yard down parallel to Enoclate Road as far as Island Road. And as I say, it is called Riggs Road. Now, why Riggs Road? Well, I'm told that in earlier days it is because, and if you look at the 1821 map, John Wood's map of that time, you will see that the croft houses, the thatched houses, which were on Newton Street, actually many of them had a croft, a long, narrow croft, that went all the way back to Sandwick Road, cutting across where the gasworks and all been filled in now. But that is why in 1956 or so, it was given the names Riggs Road. Now we carry on, have your pick down Newton Street, Enoclate Road or Riggs Road, and we come to Island Road. This was officially given its name in 1889, not as Island Road, but as Island Lane. And it was nothing more than, and there are a few of them still left down in Newton, a space between the gardens, and it ran from where its present road is, has been widened, all the way back as far as Riggs Road. And obviously it took its name because it leads, in your line of vision at any rate, to Goat Island. That seems to be why it was called Island Road. We'll perhaps have time later on to deal with the derivation of the name Goat Island. And if I, like a goat, forget, would you remind me just to regale the audience with something about Goat Island? Now, Island Road was named in 1889 by the Stornoway Borough Commissioners as the lane running from Newton at the late Captain Macaulay's mother's house to its junction with Bells Road. As I say, it's now Island Road, but it was a narrow lane, and Captain Macaulay, very famous gentleman, was the progenitor on the maternal side of the Burns family of Stornoway, Lewis Harris Tweed fame, who are still living at the corner there, at least Mrs. Burns is. Now, we now move on right down at the end of Newton, past the causeway to Goat Island. We come to what is called Battery Road. Now, this is not to be confused with Battery Park Road. Battery Road is a small, narrow road. It's now blocked off at one end, for those of you who remember when it was a thoroughfare. And that small road was nothing more than a connection between Newton, Enoclator, Kipper Road, and it was part of the area designated for the homes of the people, the officers, who were connected with the battery, which we're going to deal with in just a minute. Some of you will remember the houses, two granite-built houses on the corner of Battery Road and Seaview Terrace. Now, if I can just jump slightly further along on that side, I wonder how many of you can actually place Cannery Road. And you don't have to answer, thank you. Cannery Road. Cannery Road is the road which runs from the top of Riggs Road onto Seaforth Road past Campbell's Station, petrol station. And it is called Cannery Road for the perfectly simple and obvious reason that on the opposite side of the road from Campbell's filling station, which was until recently part of, was it the Co-op wholesale shop, was originally built in 1922 by Lord Levershulme as part of his canning factory for the fish which was going to make the fortune of the island of Lewis. Obviously, with the departure of Lord Levershulme in 1923, the buildings which he had erected fell into desuetude, and ultimately they were resurrected as part of, was it Kemp's Mill?
Yes,
thank you, Malcolm. Kemp's Mill, part of that whole complex of Harris Tweed buildings. So that's Battery Road and Cannery Road. Now let's carry on up the extension of Newton, and we'll come through Seaview Terrace. Straightforward name from the beginning of the century, actually, because again the houses on the left-hand side of Seaview Terrace were all built in connection with the battery again, and the officers, non-coms, and indeed a small hospital and mortuary were situated in these stone-built villas on, if you want, the north side of Seaview Terrace. And in 1931 or 32, Stornoway Town Council built in the park opposite these houses what we now know as the council houses on Seaview Terrace.
Cremola cottages, they were called.
Yes, is that what they were called?
They were the different colours.
Because, again, we get confused, thank you, Malcolm, with names like cottages and houses. And, again, when we come to Westview Terrace, we'll talk about cottage-type houses. So we've gone along Seaview Terrace, and we stopped at the junction left-hand, north, down Seaforth Road, which we'll come to, but more interestingly, turning right into the Hydrobode station or down on to the top of Young's Brae. Originally, or properly called Miller Road. Now, why Miller Road? It is after the two sisters of Dr. Miller, a famous Stornoway physician in the end of the 19th century. Now, Dr. Miller had a tenuous connection with that particular road, because he actually lived on South Beach Street, roughly where the beach house, beside Beach House, roughly where the Health Board offices are now. But Dr. Miller had two sisters, dear sisters who loved him very much, and after he had died, they went to live in Aberdeen, but that did not end their love affair of their native town of Stornoway. And they constantly, in many small, now almost forgotten ways, made many benefactions and benevolent gifts to the town of Stornoway. And in memory of these two sisters, the town council of the day decided, when officially naming streets, to call it Miller Road, as distinct from the unofficial name of Young's Brae. Now, what was the connection? The connection was rather prosaic and simple, I think. There was a field where the houses are now, in which Dr. Miller kept the horses that carried his gigs all over the island. So, a field there, which is now part of the Hydrobode station and became part of the battery, was Dr. Miller's field, hence the use of that name. So now let's stop.
The Miller sisters died in an accident.
Did they?
They were gassed. And that's when they named the street.
Oh, thank you. And where?
And they lived in Edinburgh, not in Aberdeen.
Well.
My auntie lived next door to them at the time. My auntie Kate.
Dear Malcolm, you must leave me to tell my own lies. My reason.
Carry on regardless.
Well, I'm going to cap that. The reason I know that his sisters had connections, perhaps not residential connections, with Aberdeen is that the lawyers were the Aberdeen firm of Ladingham Chalmers. And Ladingham Chalmers, I have a family connection with that through my sister and her husband, who was a lawyer there for many years. But Ladingham Chalmers were the lawyers who acted for the Miller sisters. So, okay, the Miller sisters lived in Edinburgh, they died in an accident, but they used Aberdeen lawyers.
At least they're in their 90s.
Anyway, I presume on the general lines that Aberdeen lawyers are much cheaper than Edinburgh lawyers. But anyway, that was Miller's Road. I mentioned Young's Brae. Now, who was Young? Well, Young was the gentleman who owned the Salmon Cottage, and some of you will remember the Salmon Cottage. It's still there, down at the bottom of the road on the left-hand side. If you look very carefully at that elongated cottage, you'll see, I think it's still there, a salmon above the door. Thank you. Now, Mr. Young, I've forgotten his first name, probably Alexander, because all famous people are called Alexander. I think it was Alexander Young. He lived there as the tenant of Sir James Matheson, as the official salmon fisherman. And like all salmon fishermen, he needed ice. Where did he get his ice? He got it in Sandwick Loch, which some of us remember, down at the bottom of the Brae. You know where the big house Sandwich Cottage is now? That stood beside Sandwick Loch, which was filled in between 1923 and 1956. It was the second of Stornoway's oak rocks. Now, some of you may not know that particularly wonderful word, Stornoway Burrow Dump. And many of us remember going down there with rubbish and whatnot. And ultimately, the loch was filled in, and it has disappeared now. But it was from that loch that Mr. Young cut his blocks of ice to to dig up to the cottage and store them. So that does give us some sort of clue about the depth of winter that prevailed at that particular time. So here we are, we're finished with Young's Brae, and we now want to go into the houses to the right or to the south of Miller Road. And they are, I think, in correct order. Keep me right, will you? Bull Creek and, come on.
Battery Park Road.
Battery Park Road. Not Battery Road, but Battery Park Road. Because it was built in the Battery Park. Or close to the Battery Park. Now, let's just talk about Battery Park Road for a minute. It was called that only in 1936, because up until then it had been called Lighthouse Road. And if you turn right from Miller Road into Battery Park Road, what is directly in front of you at the bottom of the brae? But the lighthouse. No time to talk about the lighthouse and its wonders of 1851, but it was changed at some stage from Lighthouse Street, actually, to Battery Park Road. And the one parallel to that is Bulna Creek Street. And I have here a splendid picturesque name, literally meaning from the Gaelic, the cattle enclosure on the cliff. And again, at the end of Bulna Creek, if you're not careful, you topple over the brae into the... You drop 10 feet onto the beach. That must have been the cliff. And interestingly, that street was again only officially given its name. And there was a move in 1936 to change it from Bulna Creek Street to Hudson Bay Road. Now, again, the connection will be perfectly clear. Stornoway Town Council must have been going through one of its periodic fits of historical common sense, and it decided it would call it Hudson Bay Road in memory of the Hudson Bay Company, which, as you all know, we from Lewis, as well as the people from Orkney, went out to Canada as part of the recruitment drive by Hudson Bay Company in Canada. But the good citizens of that area protested. They didn't like the new name. And after a bit of give and take, Stornoway Town Council relented, and the name Bulna Creek Street carried on as it was. And that whole scheme of houses had been built at the turn of the century by the government. An early example of government intervention in housing, and it was designed particularly for crofters and fishermen, many of whom who came from the Lochs area. And we remember what just not all that long ago when there was a wonderful lecture given in this very room called Battery Ploys by our late friend Roddy John Barts MacLeod, who told us all about that particular area. But these houses were built and let out or sold at reduced rates. What would you call it? Let to buy now or something is the common phrase, by fishermen crofters. And a little interesting thing is, if you go down that street and look at the gable end of the houses, you'll see a window in the top of the gable, which cannot be more than 2 feet by 2 feet. It's not a big window. And I am told, and perhaps Malcolm, because you have blood from that area, these windows were not windows, but they were the aperture through which the fishermen took the masts and long bits of wood from their fishing boats to take into the loft in the winter in order to maintain them and mend them. Isn't that a nice story? Is it true?
It certainly is in it some other instances.
It sounds convincing. So, next time you're in that town, part of the town, have a look at up at the gables and you'll see the windows that I'm talking about. And now we're going to make
Sandy, some of the nets weren't used in the sea.
Some of them?
They weren't used in the sea. I think they were used in fresh water.
The nets?
Yes.
Oh, never. Nobody in this island ever put a net in fresh water. Anyway, that was what the windows were, what they were finished for. So now we're going to go back up, we're going to retrace our steps up Young's Brae, Miller Road, and we're going to come and we're going to look down one of the finest, longest, straightest, clearest streets in the town, and I refer to Seaforth Road. Now, the road, Seaforth Road, was given its name in 1889 by the Stornoway Town Council, and it is clearly in connection with the landowners, the Mackenzies of Seaforth, who had been the owners of the island of Lewis from way back in the beginning of the 16th century. And interestingly, on that street, the houses there were amongst the earliest, by not the first, but the second set of local authority town council houses built in 1932, I think, Malcolm. So that was Seaforth Road. A much changed area from what it was like when I was a youngster. But on top of that, besides the houses, there are, of course, various bits of the remains of Leverhulme's Mill, which became Tweed Mills on both sides of the road, and again, which has now become, and very happily in my opinion, has become the media campus down on Seaforth Road, where that a number of organisations in connection with television, radio, archives, and that sort of wonderful thing is now situated in what used to be Mr. Stewart's Mill. Mm-hmm. What was the name of that mill, Malcolm?
James MacDonald's.
James MacDonald. A gentleman whom we could talk a great deal about, but that area there is very much improved and different from what it was, say, 50 years ago. There are many people that I had the pleasure of knowing who lived on Seaforth Road, because, again, like all housing schemes, it had a very large, happy group of boys and girls who grew up in that area. Okay, Seaforth Road, you all know that it leads on to Sandwick Road at Mosend. And we're now going to change our focus altogether and go out to Bay Head. And where is Bay Head? Well, it's not exactly the street that we know now, which is called Bay Head Street. But clearly, Bay Head is Calnavai, the original name, the head of the bay, the head of Stornoway Bay, and it went right up to roughly where the Porter's Lodge is now. We'll take the Porter's Lodge as our focal point for our next little part of street geography. Calnavai, head of the bay. Now, I said there was a village out there, and I'm not talking about Bay Head Street itself, which has its own right of comment in a minute, but at the top of Calnavai, which it has actually become the Glen River, and remember that the Glen River many years ago, well, prior to 1925, was much, much wider, and it only became filled in during the early part of the last century when it was Stornoway's first oakrock or dumping place. So all the land out behead bankment, roughly from the YM Bridge up to the Porter's Lodge, is infilled ground from the rubbish and detritus of the borough of Stornoway. And we all know that in that area there was the swing park, the bowling club and so forth. Bowling club opened 1923, Bowling Green, by Lord Leverhulme, his great friend and entertainer, Sir Harry Lauder, and another great friend and entertainer of the town council meetings, Roddy Smith. So it was all part of the behavior. Thank you for seeing the humour in that team. Anyway, we're going to go to where the Porter's Lodge is. And there was a village there with something like 500 souls in it at the time of the 1851 census. And it was called Mill Street. And although it is some distance from the mill, lattice mill up the golf course. You know, the nicely done up mill with the wheel and all the rest of it in the Willow Glen. That is presumably either that or a small mill at Manor Farm, as it was, Caberthay Hotel. The village was called Mill Street, and it was full of rather poor houses. I wouldn't dare call it a slum, because that's what connotations are, but it was a set of very poor houses. Now, what happened to Mill Street? Well, actually, it was cleared in the kindest possible way by Sir James Matheson. Now, why did he remove, as I say, in the kindest possible way, the citizens of the villagers of that area? Quite simply, because he was building the Porter's Lodge, the entrance to his large castle at the end of the driveway, which I mentioned, coming from the harbour, up South Beach, up Chim Street, and up over the Crown of Matheson Road, Rath Uar, to the entrance to his magnificent residence in the castle. Now, at the Porter's Lodge, the people from Mill Street, a slight diversion, which I promised I wouldn't do, people from Mill Street were rehoused, some of them actually in what is now Bayhead Street, and many of the rest, if not all of the rest, were rehoused with crofts and particular pieces of land up on Cross Street, which, as you know, runs off Percival Road down to the Cockle Ebb. Little story, I hope no one from Cross Street or with Cross Street connections will take. Thanks, you're warning me. Never mind. Just live with it.
I lived there for a wee while.
Did you? Well, this, Malcolm, I assure you, was before your time. You might have noticed from a census of the voters' roll that many of the people on Cross Street were called Monroe. And you will also know that the infamous factor of Sir James Matheson at the time Cross Street was being developed and given out as crofts, some bright spark, whatever his name was, when he was in the lottery for the different croft stretches, either was properly or had the wit to say when he was asked, "What's your name?" "Monroe." And he got the best piece of ground. So after that, everybody else in the queue said, "Okay, we're Monroe's too." So they all got a piece of ground there. Now, never mind if it's not true. It sounds quite nice. Anyway, Mill Street was cleared, but across the road from Mill Street, there was a gentleman who was particularly, how can I put it, stubborn, and would not go. And that was Sandy Morrison, who owned and ran Stornoway's other rope works. He became, through his sons and grandsons, a well-known Stornoway citizen. He just would not go to make way for Sir James. And I think, as in all those cases, Sir James respected a man who stood by his principles and didn't move. So the rope works stayed there, and that is why the street on which you, Malcolm, and many others lived, and is now Westview Terrace, was, funnily enough, called Ropework Road. And the ropeworks again stretched from where Charlie Barley's shop is today, was the factory, and further up the field, almost at the top of the croft, there was another of those posts that I mentioned earlier on, round which the ropes were wound as they were being woven together from the hemp. Now, I think I better go out for a minute, if I may, to what we call Manor Park, before I run out of time, although there's still an awful lot to touch upon. Going out past the Porter's Lodge, you'll all know that as you go out the road to Barbas and then the road to Harris, the main road originally went out what we now call Willow Glen Road, The road to Barvas was a secondary road, and it didn't actually go to Barvas. It only went as far as Laxtiel before it petered out, whereas Willow Glen Road actually was the road that went out to Barvas, and it went up Willow Glen Road, up over the fields at Manor Farm, where Style Park is now, down into Laxtiel Lane and across Laxtiel Lane out to Newmarket and thereafter to Barvas, up close by the waterworks, whilst the Barvas Road really stopped at the junction with the road down to North Tolster. So that road there, the Barvas Road, was ultimately called Macaulay Road, as it is to this day. And Macaulay, of course, was none other than T.B. Macaulay, the founder of Sun Life Assurance Company of Canada, of Uig stock, born but brought up in Fraserburgh, actually, of Louis' parents, but brought up on Keith Street, at the bottom of Keith Street and the junction of Keith Street and James Street, where Isabel Conning, if those of you who remember, actually stayed. So that's Macaulay Road. T.B. Macaulay actually was here in 1929 and again in 1939. And as a mark of tribute to him, the place was called Macaulay Road. I'm getting very slightly confused, but what's that amongst friends? I want now, before I go into the naming of Manor Park, to deal with a small part of the Behead area that I didn't touch upon, apart from Behead Street, a magnificent street full of lovely houses looking out onto the Willow Glen River and the harbour. I suppose, without being too subjective, the most famous person who was born and brought up, family born and brought up on Behead Street, were the Nicholsons of the Nicholson Institute. And it is there in the house at the bottom of Kenneth Street that the Nicholson family were born and brought up before they went into the great big diaspora throughout the world. And that house still stands in there. Another place where one might have put a blue plaque or something of a sort. Anyway, Behead Street became well provided for residential area. But behind it there are two or three streets that I didn't mention last week. So can I divert you up to Scotland Street, to where the Free Presbyterian Church stands, and you will know that there's a street there called Plantation Road. Okay, you got me? Plantation Road, originally called Ullapool Street. And this was in the days long before we had any ferry connection with Ullapool, although there had been many other shipping and commercial connections with Ullapool. But it was called Ullapool Street, and it was commonly referred to by the boys and girls from up there as the Pooley. So if any of you heard the name Pooley, you will know it was short for Ullapool Street. In due course, it became Plantation Road. Now, why Plantation Road? Quite simply, Lady Matheson had decided in 1880 or something of the sort to plant a set of trees on the left or west side of Matheson Road as you go down it towards Stag Road, which was going to be a small secluded plantation for the citizens of the town. And in due course, that was eaten into by the demands for housing, and it became, at a later stage, Plantation Road. Now let's just go down Plantation Road, and on the right-hand side, there's a very interesting tiny little street where in my day, if I can use that expression, you were taken by the car examiners to do your three-point turning, because it was about the only street in town you could be sure of there would be no traffic. That is, of course, the very small street called Rose Street, and there is one and only one house fronting onto it, and it is called Rose Street, would you believe it, because the first house, the only house to be built there, was built by a man called Rose, who was the one of the inspectors for poor in the town of Stornoway in towards the end of the 19th century. Again, for a different generation in our day, if I may say so, it was the home of the Rangers. Not Ibrox Rangers, but the Rangers, Katie Ranger, of happy memory, who lived had the shop on Heath Street, and also her father, Sam Ranger, a well-known painter and businessman in the town, who was also on the Stornoway Town Council. But again, we haven't got time to go into that. But as we come down Rose Street, we also, Plantation Road, we move into another street called Mackenzie Street. And Mackenzie Street is a very, very interesting street because of its name. I had always just thought that it was no more than a passing tribute to the famous Clan Mackenzie. But in point of fact, it's not. It was officially named that, I think, in 1931 or 32, when houses were an entrance off Bayhead Street, beside where he had a shop there.
Alan Craig,
where he had his shop. There was a small pathway there, and it was requisitioned by the town council to build houses upon. And at the request of one of the residents at the bottom of the street, who gave up land to allow the street to be called Mackenzie Street, she quite specifically said, if you're going to get this land, you're going to call it Mackenzie Street after no other person than Aeneas Mackenzie of great fame. Now, you won't all know who Aeneas Mackenzie was, but he was a pretty famous businessman, entrepreneur in Stornoway, who came from the Mackenzies of the Lewis Hotel, a famous family. Malcolm?
You had mentioned before he had the patent slip.
Patent slip, 32 James Street, the Lively Wood, all that sort of thing. But that's for a... The Lively Wood. Is it in this month's magazine? There's a lovely article by a certain well-known author about the Lively... It foundered on the Chicken Rock at the Bry, carrying the commissioners who were coming up to Louis.
But we're diversifying, Sandy.
I'm diversified, never mind. And Aeneas Mackenzie, being a shipbroker, got, by means which we shall not go into, all the wood from that ship, salvage wood, and he used much of it for the lovely wooden panelling, which I know well, in that house, which he owned until 1912, when it was sequestered at 32 James Street, the Tower Guest House, as we would know it now. Now, that's the end of that diversion, because I just want to mention two of our little streets there. New Street, Lagley's Bray, where Kiwi's Garage is now, and before that, it was called Campbell's Bray. Again, a Mr. Campbell, who was a blacksmith, had a business there, so it was called Campbell's Bray. Then we knew it as Lagley's Bray, although it was never properly called that. And ultimately, it became New Street at a very early stage in the town's growth. And perhaps you can keep me right, it was Anclagan. People wondered what exactly it was. Now, to my mind, Anclagan was the part of New Street that never happened. You know that New Street ends in a cul-de-sac and a wall. Now, at an earlier stage, it was projected that that street would carry on straight on its line, and it would come up onto Scotland Street, roughly at the top of Plantation Road, again, opposite the Free Presbyterian Church, if you want to use that as a beacon of geography, if nothing else. So, Anclagan was the same as New Street. We're now moving away, and let's very quickly, because I see that... When do we have to finish, Malcolm? Midnight?
Half past eight?
Oh, no, we've got plenty of time. I think we should just point out that on Plantation Road, there has in recent years been a tiny little new development round the back, if you want, of 26 Plantation, and it's called McCallum Place. It's a very small housing scheme, I think largely for disabled or handicapped people, but I'm not sure about the residents of it. No, it's for anyone and everyone. Well, anyway, it's called McCallum Place, and some of you will think about what McCallum was this. Well, for those of you who knew the late dear departed Jock of Rodel Hotel, Jock McCallum, and nothing whatsoever to do with him. But there was a lovely there was a lovely family living on Kenneth Street called McCallum Girls. And they were related to John F. McFarlane, the inspector of poor, and the McCallum girls, that was on their mother's side, the McCallum girls lived to a ripe old age. We call them the twins. And they were in themselves the kind of people that if you went to visit, you came away with a smile and a laugh on your face, because they were characters, they were twins. And of course there was a sister, Angie McCallum, we called her Angie Mackay, whose daughter Moira was for many years the classics and Latin teacher in the Nicholson Institute. Anyway, the McCallum twins, both of them, one hit the centenary.
And 104.
The other one didn't.
99.
Mm. That's pretty close to the centenary.
Yeah.
And they were lovely ladies, and the councillor for the art area at the time the scheme was being built wanted them to be memorialised by the naming of that little area of housing on Plantation Road. Now, finally, on Behead, joining Behead and Matheson Road, there is Stag Road, which we mentioned in the last lecture, and I referred to it as being like the High Street in Edinburgh, where if you didn't watch out, Gary Lou came over you, and I told you the little story which bears repeating about Mr. Watson, the optician at Stornoway in the 1930s, who was making his way from his digs on Ropework Road down on to Behead to come into town one morning, or perhaps he was going home one evening, when must have been the morning, when he was liberally showered with the night soil from the people, someone who lived on Stag Road. And
he didn't see it coming.
He didn't see it coming. He left Stornoway shortly after that. That was just an indication of Stag Road. Although, again, in my day, and perhaps in the day of many of the rest of you, there were still one or two rather derelict houses. And I always maintain that the families who lived in those inadequate houses in Stornoway before the advent of local authority houses were very fine, brave people who surmounted the difficulties of living four or five families in the one block and using communal toilets and all the rest of it. So although Stag Road had something of a no-go area in terms of social standing, it nonetheless produced a great many decent people. I don't know where the name Stag came from, unless in earlier days the stags, of which there were plenty through the castle grounds, were actually making their way down to that area. There was also a house there, and I haven't yet been able to identify it, called the Stag Inn. I think that is probably the house where the Stag Bakery or the Hebridean Guest House is to this day. And I only know it was called the Stag Inn because my granny and her husband were married in the Stag Inn in 1892. But that's of no importance to any of you except to me and my sister. But anyway, that was the Stag Road. Let's quickly jump into Manor Park and go back to where I was a few minutes ago. Willow Glen Road out to the left, the Barvis Road or Macaulay Road straight out. And that led in the 1930s right through to the 1950s, the creation of what we now call Manor Park. But of course, as the boys of that area would say, there were two distinct classes, sets, tribes of people They're with the nice people in Manor Park, and they're the ruffians in Old Manor, as it was called. I jest, of course, because it was the other way around. The rough boys were in New Manor, the nice elderly ones were in Old Manor. Now, Old Manor comprises three streets of considerable historical interest. The one is, first of all, is a safe place.
Sandy, can I interject? Yes. Very, very briefly to tell a wee story.
Okay.
A wee boy in school was asked by the teacher, what was the Battle of Assaye? And he said it was a battle between Old Manor and New Manor.
Well, that just beautifully touches on what I was going to say. That is why Assaye Place is so called. After the Battle of Assaye in India in 17-something or other, in the war between France and Britain as to who would own India, and the Battle of Assaye, the famous battle in which the 78th Highlanders of Foot Regiment, we'll come to them and again in another context in a minute if we touch on Havelock Lane. Anyway, the 78th Regiment Highlanders distinguished themselves at the Battle of Assaye, and it is for that reason that the Town Council in 1932, under the guidance of the late Alistair MacLeod, the town clerk, had the houses there named as Assaye Place. Previous to that, it had just been part of what was called Manor Park, and in one of Malcolm's excellent books, you will see how the numbers have changed. Anyway, that was Assaye Place, which you know joins Willow Glen Road with Macaulay Road with a loop up into a cul-de-sac. Assaye Place, then in front of that, and again running between Willow Glen Road and Macaulay Road, there is the no less interesting name of Canada Crescent. And of course, Canada Crescent is nothing more than to commemorate the thousands of the Lewis diaspora who went to Canada and made their fortunes, or perhaps didn't make their fortunes out there. But the point of these two streets, as indeed when we cross the road, the other street, is that the town council in the 30s had a very strong local historical interest and desire to talk about the wider world and not just rely on naming streets after people, but rather to give some indication of our history. Now, if we go across the Barbas Road, Macaulay Road, we come into what is called New Manor Park. Now, New Manor Park was built after the Second World War, from about 1945 onwards, and it was part of the whole rebuilding of houses scheme that the government, the church, the Attlee government of 1945 actually promoted. Now, the story is that money was made available for building X number of houses in New Manor. And the town clerk of the day, who I mentioned, Alistair MacLeod, being a very sensible and sharp man, instead of building houses to completion, he built foundations and then went back to the government and said, look, we've got all those foundations to build houses on. So instead of building maybe 50 houses, he was able to get money for 100 houses just to fill in the foundations which he had laid down with the first tranche of money. So let's quickly look at Manor Park and the streets therein. I suppose the first street we come to is when we turn right into Poltrona Drive. Now, where did Poltrona come from? Port Rhône, which is Port of the Seals, for those of you who know Gaelic. And it takes its name from the mythical town created in the book by R. Morrison Stephen, who wrote a lovely set of anecdotes about old Stornoway called Glimpses of Poltrona. And that is where that name came from. And then behind Poltrona, there is Morrison Avenue. And Morrison Avenue is not, as I once thought, called after, in a general sense, the Morrison tribe or clan from Ness, as might justifiably thought. It is actually after the Morrison gentleman I mentioned earlier on, who set up the clearinghouse, the London clearinghouse, and came from the Mushlikoch. So those of you who think Morrison Avenue belongs to you because your short surname is Morrison, I'm afraid you're wrong. It's got to do with this Morrison from down there. And that, of course, is not to reduce in any way the impact of the Morrison people from Ness. And joining Poltrona and Morrison Avenue is a little street with half a dozen houses called Queensland Road. And again, people say, Queensland Road. Well, there was a famous Lewis family that came here with the, what were they called, the Fife Adventurers in the 16th century. And one of the people who came up here was a Mr. Lees. And the Lees family, interesting in itself to do with St. Columba's Church and other places, but two of the Lees descendants became very prominent, successful and rich bankers out in Queensland, or North Queensland to be precise, and that is where Queensland Road came from. Yet another connection with the Lewis diaspora. I seem to remember, and my sister helped me not long ago when we were talking about a gentleman called Judge Lees, but that's a story for another time. But they were the same family, and those of you who go down on your hands and knees, as I so often do, down in Sandwick Cemetery, will see a rather lovely tombstone to that family. So that was Queensland Road. Now let's come up Queensland Road and we turn left into Bain Square. Mm-hmm. Again, a lovely little square. In my day, it wasn't a car park. It was a nice green sward where the children from Bain Square and roundabout were able to play and kick a ball and so forth. And that name is taken directly from the Bain family, who were of significance in the town of Stornoway, Bain Morrison, one small example, but the major example was John Bain Chicago, who was a banker in Chicago and made a substantial amount of money, and in 1929 was one of the significant contributors to the rebuilding of the town hall, which had been burnt down, as you all know, in 1918. So John Bain Chicago is memorialised, as well as some other families of his family who stayed in Stornoway. Provost Bain, mm-hmm. Provost Louis Bain from 1925 to 30. Thank you, Malcolm.
Holy Alec, 30 to 33.
Provost Louis Bain of Kipper fame from 1925 to 1933.
30. And he was the only provost that lived in the Lewis Castle.
That's right.
He didn't manage it.
He lived in the Lewis Castle. They didn't keep it for me, Malcolm.
It's ready now, Sonny.
Just to pick up on that, how did the Provost of Stornoway live in Lewis Castle? Well, quite simply, when Lord Leverhulme went, he did two things. He set up the Stornoway Trust of happy existence and another body called the Lewis Castle Trust, an offshoot of the Stornoway Trust. And that trust was set up specifically so that the castle could be used as the residence of the Provost of Stornoway for the time being. And John Bain did. No, John Bain lived there.
Louis Bain
lived there for a short period of time, and then, of course, it became quite clear that it was a non-starter for anyone to live in Lewis Castle. Again, another happy little story which has not, as you hope, diverted me from where I'm going. That was Bain Square. And now bounding the whole of New Manor, and indeed at a later stage, Old Manor, there is the road called Percival Road. One of those interesting roads like Ropework Road, where there's been a bit of confusion. When Percival Road got its name, those of you who were associated with Manor Park will know it was actually called Percival Road South. Why just south? And that is because the houses on the south side, town council houses, were within the borough. And the borough line, the boundary over which Stornoway Town Council had no remit, what we called Coolagrain. It's now all become Percival Road. And it isn't really that. It was originally Laxtill and Gotill Road because it was part of the Crofton area. But Percival Road is that road there, which is largely, if you want, the northern boundary of Stornoway. And finally, in New Manor, we come to MacLeod Road. And again, one is tempted to think that MacLeod Road is so named after the clan MacLeod, if you want, and if I may dare say so, the premier, most ancient, long-continuing family, tribe, clan in the island of Lewis. It's not called after them at all. It's called after a very famous MacLeod man from South Beach Street, who became one of the chief magistrates of Stornoway, and has made its name in, if you want, later generation as the Smart Family. That was just a nickname. It wasn't the proper name at all. And this MacLeod man was actually the first British linen banker in Stornoway, and the bank house, now the Bank of Scotland, was his base. But his family was on South Beach Street. It has disappeared now due to the widening of Castle Street. But a MacLeod, this MacLeod family, Murdo MacLeod, a very interesting family of which, again, unfortunately, I don't have time to dwell on tonight. It is after this man that street is named. Now, finishing up in that part of the town, just let's deal
you with Hope Road. You missed out Turkle Terrace and India Street.
Oh, I missed out Turkle Terrace. Oh. And India Street.
Yeah.
I can assure you, on many occasions going to
keep Shaney, your suitcase with you.
On many occasions going to Shaney's house on Torkel Terrace, I lost my way and I've forgotten about it. So Torkel Terrace, of course, at the back of the co-op, that terrace there is so called after Seán Torkel, the seed of the MacLeods. Those of you who know those things will know that the MacLeod clan of 300, 400 years ago split into two, the MacLeods of Lewis and the MacLeods of Harris and Skye and Torkel. He was the chief of the MacLeods of Lewis, and some of them are still buried down in the Egony Cemetery. Anyway, thank you, Malcolm. That is where Torkel MacLeod, Torkel, came from. And of course, there are many, many people of the name Torkel still in the island. And now we come to India Street, again, a very short street, and that represents the areas of Lewis diaspora that I've already talked about, where there were, on the one side, the military people who went out with the Seaforth Regiment, but also, do not forget, Colonel Colin Mackenzie of Carn Gardens. Read the plaque on the wall of the town hall if you're at all interested. A very famous Lewis man who went out to India and was responsible for the first survey. He was indeed the Surveyor General of all India. So that India Street calls in mind that gentleman and our connection with that place. Now, just moving up to the top of Torkel Terrace, we come to Westview Terrace, as it's called now. And Westview Terrace, to my mind, should remain as Ropework Road. Some of us will remember it being called Ropework Road. And Westview Terrace was nothing more than the 10 houses elevated slightly above the street on the north-east side of Ropework Road, which were built in the 1930s by Stornoway Town Council. Funnily enough, they were houses of some unusual quality and standard for local authority housing, and they were let out not to people who were particularly needy in terms of housing, but to unhoused people who could afford to pay the rent. And that is why those houses on Westview Terrace were occupied largely by school teachers and civil servants and people who could afford to pay the rent. But be that as it may, that was the original Westview Terrace. And then if you continue up my ropework road past Torquil Terrace, you come to Cooley Green House, which has now gone, of course, and has been replaced by Dunaystian. But Cooley Green House was Stornoway's first poor house, if you want to use that particular name for it. But opposite there, from the bottom of Jameson Drive up to the Percival Road junction, new houses, what was the number, 28 cottage types and 28 flats and 16 cottage types were built there by Stornoway Town Council in the 1950s. And that is now just subsumed into the rather prosaic and imaginative name of Westview Terrace. So now let's very quickly move on, in conclusion, you hope, to the lost village of Gotill. May I go into up to Gotill, Malcolm?
Yeah.
Thank you. Now I've got to try and find it.
You missed one street on the way, Sandy.
I missed another street.
Caberfae Road.
Caberfae Road.
When you were down in Newton, you bypassed it.
Right. Caberfae Road.
Will that be after the Seaforth Highlanders? The badge. Yeah,
sorry, I think when you say Caberfae Road, of the Caberfae houses at the top of Enoclade Road. Yeah. But of course, there's Caberfae Road going across
yes,
from that. You're
right.
Quite right, Malcolm, thank you. Well, again, that, as Malcolm would have told you if I didn't make it up, is called Caberfae after the Mackenzie stag and all the rest of it. And I suppose that is why the two large houses at the top of Enoclade Road, mm-hmm. just almost beside or across from MacCaskill's stores, were called the Caberfae Buildings. But thank you, Malcolm, for that. Did it take you all this time to notice?
Took me all this time to interrupt.
Anyway, we were going to go into Gotill. Let's stand at the junction of Matheson Road and Gotill Road beside the premises of the High Church on the right-hand side and Ugnish House on the left-hand side. Now, if you go back to 1900 or a bit slightly earlier, from there, apart from Gotill Farm, which we'll come to, and then shortly after that, the Lewis Hospital, there were absolutely no houses between that point on Matheson Road and the Cockleb, Broad Bay. Now, all that area was filled in during the course of the last decade of the 19th century and the 20th century. So let's go up Gotill Road, bearing in mind the name. And again, there seems to be some confusion about the name Gotill Road. Literally, I suppose it has been turned, or it was called in Gaelic, Croch na Gower, the Hill of the Goats. Now, I'm not sure whether Croch na Gower is correctly translated into the English goats, in that there may have been other connotations rather than goats. But given that I was born there, you may very well think it's entirely appropriate. but again, this is Gotill Road, Croch na Gower, an area which, as I said, there was a village in 1789, and it seems to have disappeared into the fields of what we now know or until recently knew as Goodhill Farm. And indeed, in my day, some of the fields up there were part of the manor farm. But anyway, Crocknagower disappeared, and by the 1900s, it was being resurrected as Goat Hill. And the existing place was Goodhill Farm, a building, one of the oldest buildings there are, of considerable historical interest, and again part of the diaspora, because at one stage the Sinclair family were there. The Sinclair family, who came from Lairn, emigrated to Canada and became very, very big newspaper owners and, in a small way, benefactors of the island of Lewis. But again, no time to talk about that. We're going up Goodhill Road. And then the next set of buildings on Goodhill Road, 1896, was the site of what we know as the Lewis Hospital. Again, an interesting history in its own right, but the hospital, the Lewis Hospital, was put there in 1896, a hospital built by public and subscription and the benevolence of other people long before there was a health board or anything, or even government intervention in that sort of thing, the Lewis Hospital. So now, as we go up Goodhill Road, you can look at all the lovely houses and villas on either side of the main road. Goodhill Crescent came a wee bit later on, and again, the houses there all speak of wealth, of business, of commerce, and all the rest of it. And as we go up Goodhill Road, we go on the left into the Crescent, but on the right we turn into Smith Avenue. Now, Smith Avenue, as we know, it runs down beside the school playing fields onto Springfield Road, from Springfield Road down onto Sandwick Road. And it's interesting to note that Smith Avenue was only built, I remember the day the digger, and it wasn't a digger, it was a big machine. What did they call them?
A grubby.
No. Anyway, it was a big machine with a shovel on it.
An excavator.
An excavator, something like that, yes. Went onto that site to turn it into the road that became Smith Avenue. And that part of Smith Avenue was called Smith Avenue after Dole California, whom we'll touch on in a minute, who built Springfield House and was a man from Carloway who made his money in the gold rush of 1849, came back home with his accumulated wealth, built Springfield House, was provost of Stornoway. In fact, he was the first provost of Stornoway as distinct from a chief magistrate in the 1890s. And that part of the street is called after Provost Smith. The south side of the street, that is from Springfield Road down to Sandwick Road, was, in my day, we called it the Burma Road. Mm-hmm. How many of you remember the Burma Road? Thank you. The Burma Road. It was built on a marsh, and the road load, if you want, was spread by laying down branches, trees, and all the rest of it. And it took a long time to build, something like 5 years in the building, and because it went over time, and because it was through marshy, difficult terrain, it acquired the name the Burma Road. Anyway, that part of the road, I'm led to understand, was called Smith Avenue South at one stage, after Provost Roddy Smith of later on. But it doesn't really matter. It is Smith Avenue now, incorporating the Burma Road. And here we might just for a moment touch on the road parallel to Goodhill Road and bounding the Goodhill area, Springfield Road. Springfield Road, as I say, is so named because of Provost Donald Smith of Springfield House. Now, it only became a main thoroughfare in about 1950 because it only went as far as where it until recently ended, and there was a small lane taking you past the Nicholson Institute onto the junction with Smith Avenue. That was the original Springfield Road. Springfield House, so named, we understand, after Provost Dole California's time out in America, he either lived in Springfield and called the house that, or much more likely there was actually a spring somewhere behind that house, a beautifully built house, possibly one of the loveliest interiors in Stornoway, was called Springfield Road. And it was later on that the top end was officially designated Springfield Road, and the top end runs, of course, from Smith Avenue right up to Anderson Road. Let's go to Anderson Road very quickly and briefly. Anderson Road used to be, it is now the Ring Road of Stornoway, but it used to be the main road, would you believe it, to Point. The Point Road in earlier days did not take the route we know out Sandwick Road, through Sandwick and down across the Bry, because that road actually ended in Sandwick. The road to Point actually came up Anderson Road, right up past Plasterfield and Stewart Field, right up to where it ends now at North Street Sandwick, and then it carried on across the golf course, across the airport, down to Melbourne. And that was the original Point Road, but it's all changed now. So there's Anderson Road, called after Provost John Norrie Anderson, one of the famous characters off Stornoway, a very famous provost indeed. Then we move back down the road and we come to Nicholson Road, quite clearly after the Nicholson brothers, so named when a housing scheme was built there about 1938. That was Nicholson Road. Then we come down past the Lewis Hospital to Churchill Drive, and again, Churchill Drive speaks for itself, so-called after Winston Churchill. Again, it was built 1948-49 as an extension from Goodhill Road down to Springfield Road. And on the left-hand side, if we go back up the Bray to opposite the hospital gate, we have a new housing scheme developed in the 50s and 60s. And we start off with the one coming from the top of the crescent. That is Leverhulme Drive. Again, need to say very little about it, Leverhulme Drive after Lord Leverhulme. To the left, Robertson Road and Ripley Place. Now, Robertson Road, so named after Mr. Robertson, a very famous Lewis man from Kenneth Street, who was the chief inspector of schools in Scotland. And I well remember when Robertson Road was built and so named after this very famous Lewis man, Mr. Robertson, the uncle of Ocean Robertson, the banker. Lots of interesting little stories there. And also off Robertson Road, beside the fire station and the Gibson Hostel, now gone and forming Gibson Court, there was Ripley Place. And Ripley Place was so named in 1952, when that was being built over by the County Council for Homes for Teachers and Policemen from the town Ripley in Canada, Ontario, because there had been, if you want, an unofficial twinning and linking between the town of Stornoway and Ripley in Canada. Moving very, very quickly up the Bray, we come, as I say, to Leverhulme Drive. We cross Leverhulme Drive up at the top, and we go down Balmerino Drive, named after Lord Balmerino, one of the famous Fife adventurers. And beside Balmerino Drive, or at least in its vicinity, we come at the end of Balmerino Drive onto Jimison Drive, quite clearly called after E. Norman Jimison, the very distinguished and famous surgeon of the Lewis Hospital of the 1930s, 40s, and 50s. And up at the top of Jimison Drive, there's a little cul-de-sac, Berrissey Place, again so named. It was a private housing development built in the early 1960s, so named after the island of Berrissey in Bernera, close to Bernera. And also in that area, there is Barony Square, which tells the story, the interesting story of Stornoway being created a borough of Barony in 1611. Another interesting story there. And then as we go down Evesham Drive, we come to Kennedy Terrace, a very interesting housing scheme, again built at the same time in 1951, 52, 53. And that is called Kennedy Terrace after a gentleman some of us remember with great affection called Palak, Bailey John Kennedy, who hailed from South Lochs, married into Stornoway, and is still survived by a son and a daughter, Mary Doig and John Kennedy, who lives in Sandwick. So that was Kennedy Terrace. Interesting little thing about Kennedy Terrace is that it also at one stage had a colony, the colony of Harris Tweed weavers, because under the Harris Tweed Act you had to build, you had to weave your tweed close to your home or on the croft. And the best thing for weavers who lived in Stornoway and didn't have a croft was to set up a colony. And there were two of those colonies, one on Kennedy Terrace and the other down at the back of Seaforth Road, where there are still sheds to this day. So that's Kennedy Terrace. And I think I'm going to end up, because the time's up, with Columbia Place, again, a late 1950s development directly opposite Gotill Farm. And I think it takes its name from St. Columba rather than Columbia, British Columbia in Canada, although that too was part of the Lewis diaspora. Now, ladies and gentlemen, it's 8:30. I've staged this because I know you are finishing at 8:30, and therefore there is no time for questions which I cannot answer.
Well, thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for the applause there. My microphone's gone in the blink. Thankfully, Sandy's didn't. So, I think we have time perhaps for two questions. I'll have to relay them to Sandy. So, Sandy, got any questions they would like to ask?
You'll have to tell me.
After such a comprehensive run through the town, I think they're all exhausted, Sandy. Well, if there's no questions, you've obviously satisfied the customers, Sandy.
What?
They're all very happy.
Aren't they kind?
So thank you all for coming along on what is not a very nice night. I hope you did enjoy it. And I must thank Sandy for taking us for a course round Stornoway. We certainly enjoyed it. I hope you'll get the kettle on and enjoy the rest of your evening. Good night.
Thank you all. Thank you, Dalton.